we owe it to football ourselves, and we owe it to the players that we're working with, you know, day in and day out, to allow them to enjoy their football and go and do the things that they enjoy. Every player likes to pass the ball and stick the ball in the back of the net in a certain way. And that's what we work for here.
I like to try and produce teams to play the way I would like to watch if I was a spectator. Teams that are attractive but productive. I mean, I love football with a high skill level, you know, where people are not afraid to do a trick and produce flair and things like that.
The two managers involved in this fifth round FA Cup tie here today, Swindon Town against Aston Villa. It's the first time our cameras have ever been here for a live match, and consequently we've made the local headlines today. Of course, there are two other ties around, and at half-time here we'll have highlights from Ipswich against Liverpool, that kicked off earlier, and we'll have the story of Bolton versus Southampton as well, followed by the draw live for the sixth round. Jimmy here, Alan Hansen here. Looking forward to this one, Jim. What do you feel about it?
Looking forward to it very much. It's a perfectly balanced game, although you've got a potential Premier League side against one of the others, as it were. But cup tie football is so different, which means explains a bit why so many lower division teams are still in the draw. Mm-hmm. Because the better players are more consistent. 7 times out of 8, they'll produce the skill that they're looking for. Whereas those lower down will do it 4 or 5 times out of 8. And it's just the difference in class. But on one day, it doesn't matter.
Any hunch today?
Well, Swindon have only lost 3 matches here this season. They're not used to losing at home. And Aston Villa in the first division at the moment, I mean, can be beaten. So perfectly poised. I'm not going to guess. I'll leave it to my good friend on the left.
Well, you've seen Swindon. You've seen Swindon a few times. They get a good press about their football. Is that justified?
Yeah, they try and play football, and they certainly are good to watch. They've got a 5-man defence, and they try and push the full-backs forward. They've got good touch players in the middle of the park, and Ling and Hazard, and of course they've got a prolific goal scorer up front in Shearer. There's one or two things that might go against them. One, because they try and play football, the game's liable to be open, and I think that will suit Villa. And two, when I watch them play, they try and play it out of defence. There's nothing wrong with that, but when you do it, you've got to be spot on. And I just felt that they gave the opposition 1 or 2 snatches of the ball, and I thought then that they might pay for it eventually. The game is evenly poised, but I just feel that if Villa play well, they'll win the game.
OK. Well, we had a sleet storm about half an hour ago, but now the weather seems to be perfect, so let's enjoy the match. And our commentator is John Motson.
Thanks very much, Des. And we wait for the two teams who are on their way now. And a good reception from an all-ticket capacity crowd of 16,500 here at the county ground. And according to FA rules, 25% of those tickets go to the visitors. So Aston Villa have around 4,000 fans here. And they will remember that on their last visit to Swindon in 1988, Villa clinched promotion back to the First Division under Graham Taylor, now the England manager. The game was a 0-0 draw. And today, there's only one survivor on the pitch from that last meeting, and there he is, 27-year-old Colin Calderwood, the Swindon captain, who's been here since the club's fourth division days and who last week scored both goals from centre-back against Brighton. But the real goal machine here at Swindon is 29-year-old Duncan Shearer, who'll be on the lookout today for his 29th goal of the season. So we can take a check on the Swindon team. Their left-back, number 3, Paul Bodin, has just returned to Swindon from Crystal Palace. Number 7, Mick Hazard, played in the cup final for Spurs against QPR 10 years ago, when the winning goal came from the Swindon player-manager Glenn Hoddle, who's injured at the moment. And so when we look at the Swindon formation, you'll see that his normal sweeper's role is taken up by number 10, Ross McLaren, who himself passed a fitness test on a stomach injury. Shearer's partner up front, also a former Chelsea player, is David Mitchell. He's an Australian international. Well, now Aston Villa, who have their own League of Nations, of course, and two of them back today. Number 2, Darius Kubicki, the Pole, he's in the side. And so now is Dwight Yorke, who missed last week's match with injury. He's at number 8. And they'll look to his pace, Aston Villa, because their formation shows Yorke expected to play up front with Regis, which gives them 2 wide men, 18 years old Steve Froggatt on the left, and on the right, number 7, Tony Daly, who'll be looking for a personal performance to enhance his England claims this coming week. Well, Trevor Brookings with me. I don't know what you make of the conditions here. We had sleet, snow, rain and sunshine this morning.
Yes, as you say, it has been everything. I think it definitely is better than yesterday, when I think most sides did struggle with the wind, the strong wind. It is a fairly brisk breeze blowing down, in fact, from the end where Swindon are kicking in at the moment from left to right. But I would have said that more than anything that the wet weather would have helped it, because when you used to play myself, I loved the zippy top, and with the conditions, it will zip across the surface. And I think with both sides liking to pass the ball, it will favour that style. And so I'm looking forward to an open game, and we might get one of our live games with a few goals, I think.
Well, those two young men will not forget this day. Nine-year-old Stephen Brown with the fair hair and Gavin Bailey, the two mascots. And as Ray Lewis welcomes them and the two captains, there's the Aston Villa manager, who's been a winner at Wembley twice with Manchester United, once with Sheffield Wednesday in the League Cup, and Andy Gray, who played in the winning Everton side in the 1984 FA Cup final. So plenty of Wembley pedigree down there on the Villa bench. And referee Ray Lewis from Surrey. It's now a quite beautiful afternoon here. Glenn Hoddle has appealed to the fans at Swindon for rather more vocal backing in his programme notes. He wants to whip up the atmosphere down here at the county ground, and they've certainly got the chance to do that today. It's a great opportunity for Swindon Town, whose players you'll get used to as we open up the commentary. Not as familiar, of course, as the Aston Villa lads, but Swindon, all in red, will play from right to left in the first half. Aston Villa, white shirts, blue shorts. And this is Mick Hazard, who you will know, to number nine, Tom Jones. And already Kerslake, the right back, starts to charge down the wing. That's the way they play here, with the two fullbacks pushing up all the time. Kerslake is number two. Cyril Regis there for Villa. Gary Parker through to Yorke. Hazard. Jones. Play on. It was Martin Ling who went down, and Parker for Villa. Mitchell for Swindon. Got it back to number 10, Ross McLaren, the spare man. Forward there by Taylor, and there goes Mitchell, knocked over by Paul McGrath, and a free kick for Swindon in a dangerous area in the opening minutes. They've pushed Calderwood and Taylor up on the far side. Calderwood is a real threat at set plays, the centre-half. But there are four players waiting to come in, as you can see. Hazard may have something to do with this. This is Tom Jones with the shot, and it deflects away to the far side, but I think there's probably a throw-in given. Here's Jones. Jones again, number nine. Aston Villa have put out the holders, Tottenham Hotspur, and then had a 4-3 win at Derby. But this may be a different sort of test against a team who, as we've said, like to pass the ball around, Glenn Hoddle's side. And the Swindon manager takes a seat upstairs in the first half. And well protected against the wind. Kubicki. Sean Teal for Aston Villa. Hardly been in the Swindon half yet. Here's Parker. And he won't get there now either. Ling. Shearer's gone to the left, Mitchell to the right. Here's Shearer. Hazard. Ling. Bowden's well forward here. Number three, here he is. Ling. Jones. Hazard. Oh, well played by Mick Hazard. And he's going to get the corner, is he? Well stopped by Les Seeley. Seeley's kept Nigel Spink out the Villa goal now since, well, I think it was back in October that he took over. Had his moment since, one way or another, but he's still there. Header by Sean Taylor. Hazard again. This stage might suit Mick Hazard. He's always been a good ball player. Jones. Forward by McLaren. Well, what do you think of this sweeper system? Is it going to work?
Well, I always like the sweeper system. Ross McLaren has taken over since Glenn Hoddle's got injured, but a lot depends on him because he's always the get-out man, and then he's the one who should link it through to the midfield players such as Hazard and Ling. And you can see already that they sort of go forward in little clusters, pass it close, and then just hope to get somebody out wide or play it through to the front men.
Well, that is McLaren, in fact. Cyril Regis has gone down injured. I would imagine, Trevor, that the main threat to Swindon will come from the pace of the likes of Daly and Yorke.
Well, I'm sure if you've been Ron Atkinson, he would know that Bowden, left-back, and Kerslake, the right-back, are very important to give the Swindon side width to get forward in attacking position. But if it does break down, those channels down the flanks with Daly and Yorke and Froggatt will be the areas I'm sure he'll hope to capitalise on the counter-attack.
There's David Mitchell taking a breather as Regis received attention. 5 minutes gone here at Swindon, and McLaren just marshalling the others as the referee restarts the game by dropping the ball. McLaren forward, looks for Shearer. Number two, Kubicki. But it fell for Shearer, that was a bit ambitious. Now on the far side for Villa, it's Staunton at left back. A little bit of dressing room gossip. Villa have changed their penalty taker after Dwight Yorke's mixed experiences at Derby. Here's Regis. Yorke. Froggatt. Maybe saying either Staunton or Parker would take them today if they get a penalty. This is a club, Swindon Town, that's seen quite a lot of activity over the last few years. You'll recall that they were at one point promoted to the first division under Ozzy Ardiles, but then a case involving alleged illegal payments was brought up, and they never went up. On by Shearer, here's Ling, takes on Kubicki. It's still Ling. Kubicki held him off for a while. Kerslake's coming up now on the right. Still Kerslake. Jones!
Well, David Kerslake did brilliantly out wide there. I mean, to go past two people, that is what he and Bowden are excellent at. Tight in the corner, he makes the opening, pulls it back, and really a snatch volley from Jones, but it would have been past Seeley before he would have been able to react to. Great move, and I'm sure that's lifted the home crowd.
Tom Jones had the shot, and as you say, it whistled over the bar. McGrath for Villa. Froggatt to Regis. Nice return. There's two in the middle here. There's Tony Daly, there's Dwight Yorke, and there was Kevin Richardson coming in for the shot that was blocked. Good pass by Hazard out of defence. Found Jones. Wide to Mitchell, but it's out.
just see in the space of a couple of minutes how both sides can break defences down. Suddenly, Kerslake was just caught a bit short himself, and they got down his side, and the cross was eventually then went to Richardson, the shot blocked. But the game will gradually open up as this match progresses, definitely. Staunton. This is Regis. Froggatt. And Hazard run out of space, really. It's a throw into Aston Villa. It's going to be Kubicki to take it. In goes McGrath. Comes to Richardson, Kubicki, who slipped, but still got the cross in. And a sustained spell this for Aston Villa, down in the corner. McGrath still up. There's McGrath, nearly ran for Richardson. That was Mitchell looking for Hazard on the far side. There was some good defensive play by Ling there for Swindon that really cleared that danger. But this is Parker for Aston Villa with Froggatt outside him. Forward run in the centre by Kevin Richardson into the penalty area. Still Parker. It's come to Daly. And he brings a save out of Nicky Hammond, Tony Daly. With 10 minutes gone. Good brisk start. It's Teal. Trying to find Froggatt. There's McLaren. This is Kerslake. Jones heads it through, Mitchell on the chase, caught the heels of Kubicki, this is McGrath. Parker, Staunton, looking for Froggatt. And he's not managed to force the corner. This is 18 years old Steve Froggatt, born in Lincoln, who's just come into the Villa first team in the last few weeks, orthodox left-sided player. No score if you've just joined us here at the County Ground. Swindon Town of the second division against Aston Villa of the first. Jones, McGrath. Hazard. So Sean Taylor coming through to beat Cyril Regis. Richardson. Now McLaren for Swindon. Calderwood. Just wonder, Trevor, whether this wind is having an effect on the game.
Well, it's a bit blustery. It's blowing downhill, down the end from Aston Villa. They've got the advantage this half, so you see some of the balls when Swindon decide to knock it a little bit longer, hanging in the air. But at the moment, I think if both sides are accustomed to knocking it on the floor can adjust that, I don't think the wind will be too bad.
Well, here's Parker for Aston Villa. Bowden. Kubicki. Bowden again. Hazard won't reach that. It's come to Staunton and now to Richardson. Staunton again. He's got Froggatt outside him. Regis and Daly waiting in the middle with Yorke. Comes off Calderwood. Richardson. Daly. Richardson. And Jones for Swindon. Finds Shearer, nicely pushed back to Mick Hazard. And there's a player breaking well on the left, here, it's Ling on the left-hand side, if he can find him. Still has it, he just took it a bit too far. And Ling was left with his arms in the air, waiting for a pass that never came. Here's McGrath for Villa. Daly. In the middle, Yorke and Regis. Daly having a run at them for the first time. Very exciting when he gets on the ball. A good challenge by Bowden. Just a slight pause while Dwight Yorke ties up his boot. That's why Kibitski's waiting, looking now for Regis. He can try again. This is Gary Parker. Daly. And still. Yorke retrieved it. Froggatt. Bowden's header out, whistle's gone. There was a moment ago there where Hazard went right into the heart of the Villa defence but didn't release the ball.
Well, they had four against three. I mean, it was one of those where he did well for a while. He carried it and waited for somebody, one of the defenders, to come to him, but he didn't release it at the right time. Either of the wide players were the one. Once McGrath committed himself, but he held on too long and, of course, lost possession.
Been playing for a quarter of an hour, and there's good movement in this cup tie by both sides. Froggatt for Aston Villa, Staunton. Ling made a super run down the left in that last Swindon attack. He's just, or rather, he's come back here for the second spell after being with Southend. There he is again. Headed by Taylor. Nice touch by Hazard. And here's Ling again. Good football by Swindon. Nice passing. Jones. And now it can go wide to Bowden. Shearer's on this side as well. Hazard.
A little smile from Mick Hazard. I think, given the benefit of the doubt, he was trying, believe it or not, to spread it wide to the right to Ling and sort of try to hit it with the outside of his right foot, but sliced it and did need some sorting out to find out where he intended to pass that one.
He's across the goal there by Calderwood to McLaren, but here's the third central player, Taylor. McLaren again. They're trying to stay onside here, Swindon. Teal. Oh. A little bit of angry reaction there. Staunton, Regis found Parker, Dwight Yorke goes to the left, but, this is Shearer, Daly, takes on Bowden. Hazard, now well played by Ling, he's found Shearer, now they've got Jones in the middle and Mitchell. And it was Staunton, a very firm piece of defending because there were two Swindon players coming in on his blind side, Steve Staunton. And Ling again, very involved in the Swindon attack. McLaren. Well, Swindon playing some progressive football, Trevor.
Well, it's a bit sort of long-range shot from Ross McLaren. They've had about three or four from about 30 or 40 yards, but it was a build-up play just before that. I mean, long way out. I don't think you're going to beat Leicester City from that range, but I mean, that's three or four attempts. It seems to be as if it's something they've talked about beforehand, let's shoot on side. But I do like the look of Martin Ling, who's just sitting sort of behind the front two, and he's the one joining from midfield.
There was an offside flag up there. Swindon are in fact the top scorers in Division 2 with 52 goals. So we're entitled to expect some attacking football. This is Richardson and Staunton stretching now in a more attacking role. Here's Dwight Yorke. Froggatt. It'll be Staunton with the throw. Regis just swapping positions there with Yorke. Header out was by Calderwood. This is Parker. Bobble on the pitch confused Sean Teal, and with 20 minutes gone and no score, it's Hazard for Swindon. Bowden, good looking ball, that's Mitchell, he's on here, it's Mitchell for Swindon. Good save by Les Seeley, gets all the marks there, the Villa goalkeeper, and David Mitchell knows it's a chance missed. He was clear, there was no flag, and he was right in on the goalkeeper. Seeley, very good in the one-against-one position, Trevor, and my goodness me, save Villa there.
Well, they had a goal written all over it, didn't it? They're caught flat, Villa trying to play the offside. Tries to be a bit precise with his right foot, but Les Seeley did extremely well, spread himself. One of those preps afterwards you can say, could he have lifted it over him?
Here comes Swindon again. This is Jones. Ling! Well, Seeley won an FA Cup winner's medal 2 years ago in the replay with Manchester United. He was in their successful European Cup Winners' Cup final last season. And at 34, he still seems to be the man for the big occasion. It's a corner at the other end, meantime, to his team, Aston Villa. Staunton is forward and so is Regis. Dwight Yorke takes up the goal line position and McGrath now goes there as well. Well, the header out actually hit the referee, but anyways, he's already given the goal kick. So there we are, about halfway through the first half. Swindon 0, Aston Villa 0, but Swindon have created the best chance. Mitchell right through on Seeley. This is Kubicki. Hazard. And again, they're looking for the quick through ball. He's played it to Ling this time. Shearer to his right. Here's Shearer. Mitchell is in the centre. But he won't be found there.
Good carrying by Martin Ling again. It's the one that Aston Villa playing a flat back for, and then the midfield lads as well. They're not quite sure who should be picking him up, and he's the one getting the space.
He's seen plenty of the ball, certainly, in this opening period. Here's Parker for Aston Villa. Teal. Yorke. Staunton. here's Ling again. Now it's Jones who starts a forward run from midfield. Number nine tries to head it into the path of Mitchell. McGrath copes with that and finds Richardson. Now it's across with Parker, and Villa have five men up here. One of them is Froggatt on the left. Rolls it inside to Cyril Regis. But he's hit plenty of better shots than that.
I don't think he'll want us to replay that one, but I'm surprised so far that they're playing two wide people like Froggatt and Daly. Villa haven't got them out, the ball out to them quicker so as they can have a run at defenders. That cross came in and wrong-footed the Swindon defence, but that's one of the few occasions that they've been able to get the ball wide early.
Staunton. Regis. Jones. You don't see Swindon pass back to the goalkeeper too often, but you do see the goalkeeper roll the ball out when he starts an attack. That was forward by Taylor. Bowden. Hazard. And now looking at the cross towards Kerslake. It wasn't really on, but it was to Jones. And finally, Kerslake does get the ball from Ling, and he plays it back into Hazard. Richardson. See there how Nicky Hammond throws the ball out to Bowden. That's what Glenn Hoddle has encouraged his team to do, rather than the huge kick down the middle, which most goalkeepers seem to practice these days. Here's Froggatt. And takes on Ling. He's got support coming in here from Parker. And one of the Swindon defenders went down in a collision with Regis. What do you think about that, starting the attack by rolling the ball out from the goalkeeper?
Well, if you're a passing side, it makes sense. I mean, the argument from coaches would be that you've got to have the confidence in your defenders that they're not going to give the ball away in the wrong position and then give the opposition a chance to shoot themselves on target. If you feel that defenders are happy and technically good, then for me that's the way to play. And of course, you must have a sweeper. I mean, Glenn Hoddle himself has been playing the early part of the season, but Ross McLaren is there now, who is the get-out ball in those situations.
Here's Kubicki for Aston Villa. This is Dwight Yorke. Villa's attack has been drawing blanks in league games recently. They haven't been scoring, and certainly in this opening half hour, their attacking play has been uncoordinated.
If Dwight Yorke is fully fit, he looks very leggy and sort of lacklustre. I mean, he's been the man in form, and against Derby, then he got a knocker, hasn't played since, and whether he's just taken a gamble with his fitness, because he's given the ball away. Usually his touch is very good, and he likes to take on defenders, but today he hasn't been able to get into it at all.
Kerslake with the throw, Shearer. McGrath to Daly. Daly's lost the ball. Mitchell, Jones, they've got players coming left. It's Bowden. And he's round the back, Bowden, but it just ran out.
I think you've got to give a lot of credit to Paul Bowden not to go down looking for a penalty there. I've seen a few matches where Kubicki just went in to try and make the tackle. He just eluded him, but he did clip his heel, and Bowden carried on trying to get the cross or shot in. But I've seen a few players go down looking for the penalty there.
Actually, the two best moves Swindon have had have come when Tony Daly has lost the ball, which is something that won't please Aston Villa too much. Here's Staunton. Froggatt's gone down the left. But the cover is on from McLaren. Hazard making space again. McLaren comes forward, finds Bowden. Mitchell makes his run again, and again he's onside. They've got Ling and Shearer waiting in the centre here, Swindon. Jones is another alternative, and so is Hazard here. And it hits it, and it's Ling! And Seeley saves the second one, the defender blocked the first. Exciting stuff again from Swindon Town. Mitchell timed his run beautifully there and opened up the whole game. Mick Hazard drove the first shot, back off the defender. Martin Ling curled the second, Seeley was there. Staunton. And Swindon, as they said they would, carrying the game to Aston Villa at every opportunity. And Hazard now very involved. It Teal was there, and it's all a bit helter-skelter over that side at the moment, but it's being given and taken in good part. Half an hour gone, no score. Swindon have made the best chances. Here's McLaren. Taylor's joined the attack now, number six offside, but it just goes to show, Trevor, with this system, it doesn't have to be McLaren who's the spare man. Taylor was up there.
Well, that's the beauty of it. Once the players understand it and they can interchange and go from deep, and that's when, especially when you're playing a side at Aston Villa who today are playing the offside game more than I normally see them, and if they are playing that sort of flat back four, you've got to get people running from deep, and they're the ones that on a couple of occasions people going from deep have caught them out, and that's where in fact they've got the chances. And Swindon at the moment have definitely been much a better side.
Oh yes, they're absolutely on top, aren't they? Doesn't always work in your favour. One wonders perhaps if things will change before half-time, because Aston Villa must play better than this. And again, the build-up starts right at the back, but Villa this time have shut them down. Here we go again. This is McLaren. Hazard. Hazard again, he's found Jones. Bowden is forward now on this side. Regis. This is Teal. And again, Richardson. Daly. Kubicki. And that's Bowden stepping in.
Excellent overlap by Kubicki. It's a poor ball in, though, from Tony Daly. He can be very frustrating as much as exciting. I mean, when sometimes a simple, easy ball is on, that's the one that lets him down, and on that occasion he had a two against one, and that was when the fullback wanted the ball in front of him and not behind him, and that's what I think why people look at him and wonder, and I think that's what the England manager has done. Interesting to see if he does get a chance against France.
I think it would be fair to say that Daly needs to find a bit more consistency to his game, and the same probably will be said about Yorke. Forward by McGrath.
You mentioned Dwight Yorke there. I must say, I said he hadn't been able to get into the game. He doesn't often play up front. He plays wide net. Watching him, he seems uncertain as to where to run as a forward player. And I wouldn't be surprised if they continue in the sort of way that they have done this first half. He might swap Daly and Yorke for the second half. He seems perhaps happier out wide.
Well, certainly Daly's played more in the central position, hasn't he, with Regis. This is Kubicki. At the moment, Swindon are coping very comfortably back there. That was Mitchell. play on, says Ray Lewis. This is Ling. He's got Shearer to his right. And he really goes at them, this lad, from midfield. And can Shearer reach it? He can, and it goes fizzing across the six-yard box. Mitchell couldn't get there. But another really dangerous attack by Swindon, and well initiated again by Martin Ling. Here's Bowden. And now Daly, Yorke to Staunton. And there goes Regis, and Nicky Hammond out quickly.
Certainly it was a great ball from Martin Ling here. You see, he's knocked Shearer out wide across the face of the goal. Perhaps if he could just have held it up a bit, Shearer, in order for Mitchell to get a bit closer, right across the face of the goal. But it was that man Ling again. Good vision. He held it up, played it out wide to Shearer. And again, Villa's discussions afterwards, who's supposed to be picking him up?
I don't think they really know, Trevor, to be honest, at the moment. This is Hazard. I don't know who's picking up the man on the right either, but it went over Kerslake. And there's some really good imaginative football coming from the Swindon midfield. With 10 minutes left in the first half. Bowden. Trying to curl it through for Shearer. There's McGrath. Kubicki. Oh, he's given it straight to Mitchell. Shearer. Hazard. Referee's blown. But where was it? Richardson on Hazard. And it looks to be just outside. It's played in here by Shearer. And Mick Hazard is on his way. Yes, it's definitely outside the area. Good decision. Free kick to Swindon. Calderwood has come up on the far side. Tempting, I would have thought, here for a curler. They might wish Hoddle was playing just at this moment. Bowden shaping up as though to take it with his left foot. Moves away. It was McLaren in the end, but the Villa defensive wall did its job. Here's Kerslake, right across to Bowden. Good pass. Hazard. Bowden again. Goes behind Shearer and Mitchell this time. And Aston Villa fully stretched here, the first division team, by second division opponents who are playing the way they know and making it very effective.
They're two good free kicks, haven't they, on the edge of the penalty area, where I thought they might have made better use of them. They've perhaps been a bit over-elaborate and haven't actually even got the shot in properly, and they've been blocked. I think Glenn Hoddle will be disappointed because they were both only on the edge of the 18-yard box, which I think on both counts you should end up getting a shot on goal.
Yes, 8 minutes left in the first half. Swindon 0, Aston Villa 0 in the FA Cup fifth round. And I wouldn't have thought it was the most comfortable half for Messrs Atkinson and Gray. Here's Richardson, though, for Villa. Yorke. Still Dwight Yorke, and there's Regis and Calderwood just in time. Corner to Aston Villa. Froggatt will come across to take it, and now it's Swindon who have to get their marking right, because Staunton is right up in the six-yard box, and so now is McGrath. This is Parker. Now it's Staunton. Kevin Richardson is well forward in this attack. Here's Yorke. Well, they don't seem to get forward. Yeah, they might now. Yorke again. Good run by Dwight Yorke. And he scored out of nothing. Beautifully taken, and Swindon are stunned. 39 minutes, and against the run of play, Aston Villa produce a goal. And it's Dwight Yorke who bent his shot round number five, Calderwood. I rather think, Trevor, that Nicky Hammond may have been unsighted.
He was unsighted, but for the first time, Dwight Yorke dropped deeper, got the ball, and was able to run at defenders, which he hadn't been able to do for the first 30 minutes. And suddenly, that little bit of extra skill hit it with the outside of his foot. And to be fair to the goalkeeper, Nicky Hammond, I don't think he had a lot of chance there with the wind assisted right into the corner. How often do you see a side dominate, have the better chances for 35, 40 minutes, and then let in what is relatively a soft goal because they've denied them any scoring opportunities and suddenly find themselves one down, and the chins will be a bit down when they go in as well at half-time.
It's Yorke, the top scorers, 15th of the season. 5 minutes left in the first half. Well, I don't know what I'd feel if I was a Swindon supporter now. I mean, they've had all the game, they've created nearly every chance that's been going. And then, with almost the first shot that Nicky Hammond's had to face, the ball is in the net, but that's cup football, and it's up to Swindon now to do something about it. Staunton. I don't think Yorke's looked very mobile either, the goal scorer. He seems, as you said, to be almost hobbling a bit, but he certainly struck the shot well. This is Hazard to Bowden. So Swindon 0, Aston Villa 1. And it's the Villa supporters you can hear now at full throttle. Taylor, Jones, Bowden, there goes Mitchell, it's Teal the defender, dealt with it well, because there were three Swindon players around him. Shearer and Mitchell waiting for the cross, this is Regis to Daly. To Yorke, and Regis now coming down the right-hand side, but he may have run offside. Yes, he did. It wasn't Daly in the middle, it was Regis. Hazard. Jones. Has it again. Bowden. It's a free kick to Aston Villa. Francis Ling. Good tackle by Parker. And Villa lifted by the goal, now have Froggatt down the left-hand side. Into the last minute of the first half then, Swindon trailing by 1-0. This is Jones to Bowden. Mitchell and Shearer waiting in the centre again. Daly. Regis. Calderwood, offside. What's your summary of the first half, Trevor?
Well, I thought Swindon passed it well initially. Very important save from Les Seeley, from David Mitchell, has to be the best chance of the first 45 minutes. Martin Ling picking the ball up in the space behind the front two, done well. And Villa, for me, were disappointed then. Just when you think, well, are Swindon going to get the goal before half-time? Aston Villa conjure up a move. It was quite a slow build-up, but Dwight Yorke dropping deep for once and found a bit of space. He had struggled playing against three centre-backs and then suddenly got a goal out of nothing. And Villa, I think, and Ron Atkinson will be very relieved to go in at half-time 1-0. I think they would have been in for a bit of a shake-up at half-time, even if it had stayed 0-0. But to be 1-0 up, I don't think he'll realise that they haven't played well that first 45 minutes and they're a little bit relieved to go in ahead.
Well, you're what they say sometimes if your name's on the cup, but I saw Ron Atkinson quoted this week as saying that's nonsense. The only people whose names are on the cup are those who've won it already, which is, I think, pretty fair comment. Villa have won the cup seven times. Only Tottenham have won it more, but you have to go back to 1957 for the last time Aston Villa lifted the trophy. Swindon's best FA Cup performances way back in the early 1900s, two semi-finals. But they do, of course, have the memory of that League Cup triumph over Arsenal back in 1969. McLaren. Glances off McGrath. This is Kubicki. Calderwood. And the referee blows for half time, and the cheer comes from the Aston Villa corner of the county ground, because Dwight Yorke's goal against the run of play gives the First Division team the advantage that they were going to be denied, it seemed, in the first half hour when Swindon had nearly all the play and created some good chances. But it's goals that count, and at half-time at the county ground in the FA Cup fifth round, it's Swindon Town 0, Aston Villa 1.
I'm sure you'll know by now, though, why so many people are fans of the way Swindon play football, but there ain't no justice, really, Alan.
Well, Swindon have been terrific in the first half. Aston Villa have got out of jail. They could have been 2-0 down and on their way out the cup. Ling and Hazard have been fantastic in the middle of the park, but Aston Villa have not picked them up at all. They've let them run the play, dictate the play. As I said, they could have been 2-0 up quite easily. But the problem they've got now, obviously, is they've played so well in the first half and they're going in 1-0 down.
Shows you can buy a player for £15,000, Martin Ling.
Great skill, great running ability, great passer. Mm-hmm. He's been fabulous in the first half.
But 0-1. Jim?
You can buy a lot for 15,000 that can't play as well.
As I think you've proved once or twice.
What I was thinking, that if it is on the cards for Swindon to get to Wembley, you could almost guarantee a first-class game of football. And that's as big a tribute as you can pay them, really, I think, for that half of football. Mm-hmm. It's a delight to watch. And at the moment, it is a travesty of justice, the one goal. But you were predicting it almost before it happened.
I was. I had a feeling in my water, as it were, that
it was a sleepy sort of start to it, really. Dwight Yorke got it. He didn't seem to be moving that well, but it was enough just to make the room. There's the lunging foot. There was just a deflection, I thought, there, off the defender. I think it did move to the right, which really excuses Hammond. He saw it late anyway, which was part of it. We don't get the same angle, but we see he got enough power there into the shot to make it difficult to deal with anyway. And there's the keeper. He's in the centre of the goal. The ball was moved just a yard to the right.
And we hadn't seen much of Dwight Yorke up till that point.
Dwight Yorke had appeared to have some difficulty in getting into the game. And as I say, we feel unhappy about it because we do like a bit of justice, and let's hope that it'll be put right in the second half.
Right. We'll have a further look at some of the Swindon play in that half in a few minutes' time, but of course there are two other cup ties today, not least Ipswich against Liverpool, and these are the highlights of what happened there. The commentator is Graham Lloyd.
Burrows. Played back by Stockwell. And Burrows under pressure from Stockwell. And if that's a booking, that would be his 10th this season, David Burrows. Perhaps the referee will give him the benefit of the doubt. Stockwell ran through. It was a pretty rash challenge. Grovelaar with the save. Thompson with the shot, nearly took Grovelaar by surprise, almost caught out. Witten to Stockwell. Kiwomia turns right, the cross, oh, over the bar from Gavin Johnson. Well, there was a real chance for Ipswich. Kiwomia made it. The flick on was from Stockwell, and Johnson over the top. A disjointed start to this fifth round tie. Marsh and Palmer before Thompson brings the ball away. Johnson. Gazelle has got a little bit of room in which to work. Witten. Kiwomia. Johnson. Kiwomia. Well, there was another chance for Ipswich. 20 minutes gone. A good move. The final shot. Lack conviction at the crucial moment. Saunders for Liverpool. He's through. Dean Saunders taking his time and missing the target. Well, action at both ends here at Portman Road. It should have been 1-1. Here's the Ipswich chance. Johnson's cross. Kiwomia. No problem for Bruce Grovelaar. Kiwomia. Nicely down to Johnson. This looks promising for Ipswich. Johnson on a run. Oh, just couldn't get the final cross in. Mark Wright made the interception. Gavin Johnson the run. That perked up the crowd. Grovelaar punched it once, punched it twice, and it's another corner to Ipswich. There was the first punch, and there the second. Perhaps he would have been better catching it. Witten. Grovelaar again punching. And surely the best policy would be to try and collect it with this wind. It's flying all over the place. There's some height in that Ipswich attack. Grovelaar under pressure. Oh, against the bar by John Walk. Well, the corner was from Thompson. Swung to the far post. Walk was waiting. Inches away from scoring against his old club. Saunders. Header by Wright. Pushing. Alf Butch making clear the reason why the goal isn't being allowed. Pushing at the far post. The wind dying down for a moment to enable Thompson to take the free kick. Dazelle. And Grobbelaar hasn't got it. Burrows with the clearance. Stockwell. Flicked on. Dazelle. It's hit the post. Johnson was up there. And what another let-off for Liverpool. Jason Dazelle looked to be in. Good challenge by Ray Houghton. The ball coming off Houghton against the post. Lucky let-off for Liverpool.
0-0, the cup favourites are still very much in business. Well, another match that kicked off at the same time as the one here, Bolton against Southampton. There have been a couple of goals there. Tony Gubber reporting.
And this one will be taken by Letizia. Ruddock and Richard Hall are both at the far side of the penalty area. Here comes Ruddock. Hall! Richard Hall, they stole in at the back, the two central defenders. And Bolton hadn't spotted them. 26 minutes gone, and somewhat against the run of play, Southampton from Division 1 take the lead. Ruddock came in first, Hall was behind him, and it bounced right in front of Michael Brown on the near post, and Southampton have taken the lead. Well, Southampton will presumably try to do the same here that they did two or three minutes ago. Letizia has again come across to take the corner, and just to the left, completely ignored by Bolton, Ruddock and Hall have stolen up to the far edge of that penalty area again. And now they're going to make a run as this corner's taken. Here they come. Hall! And it's in. They've done it twice, and Bolton have been caught napping. And what were they thinking of? Richard Hall gets his second goal, and it's almost identical to the one he's just scored. So two in the space of 3 minutes for Richard Hall, and that might well have killed off this fifth round cup tie in the first half. Poor Bolton.
That's where it is. Southampton two up there at half time. Now, the man perhaps responsible for getting Swindon to play such attractive football here in the first place is Ozzy Ardiles, and he's here now with Ray Stubbs.
Ozzy, the way Swindon played in the first half, they're going to be very disappointed at going in a goal down.
Well, yes, football is a very cruel game sometimes. I believe that Swindon played an extremely good first half, but somehow they didn't take the chances, and obviously at the end of the, nearly at the end of the first 45 minutes, Aston Villa nicked.
If you were Glenn Hoddle, what would you be saying now?
I would say to the boys to carry on playing in the way that they have been playing. They are finding a lot of space in midfield, and if they carry on believing in themselves, they are going to have chances in the second half, and hopefully they are going to put the ball in the net.
If you were Ron Atkinson, what would you be saying to your players?
I think they will have to... In a lot of ways, I believe Aston Villa have been overplayed this first 45 minutes, so obviously from Aston Villa point of view, they will have to put a lot of more pressure in midfield especially.
It's great the way Swindon play football, attempt to take the game, isn't it?
It's absolutely great, yes. It's a pleasure to see Swindon play, yes.
Can I ask you any news on whether you'll be going back into football soon?
Well, that's too early to say, but obviously I am looking to go back into football, but at the moment it's too early to say.
It must be very disappointing having worked so hard at Newcastle.
Well, yes, it is disappointing. I spent a long time there. I was very happy there, and I believe that we were building for the future, but suddenly it happened what it happened, so it's gone.
Your old boy's doing you proud. Thank you for talking to us.
Thank you.
Right, let's enjoy the second half, see if Swindon can get back into it. If you're just joining, it's Swindon 0, Aston Villa 1, Dwight Yorke the scorer, and once again, it's John Motson.
Well, I think we've paid due and deserved respect to Swindon Town's performance. It ought to be said, I suppose, that Aston Villa's away form in the FA Cup this season is something that their team and supporters will be pretty satisfied with. They won at Spurs in the third round replay, you'll remember, at White Hart Lane, 1-0. And then 4-3 at Derby in the fourth round. And now in the fifth round, they lead Swindon 1-0, albeit somewhat against the run of things. But as I said earlier on, in the FA Cup,
anything's possible, and you don't always get what you deserve, and sometimes you get something that you might not at that particular time. But long way to go here at Swindon. Ozzie Ardiles, who, as you said, was responsible for dictating the way Swindon play their football. Glenn Hoddle has carried that on. And those two together at Spurs, with Mick Hazard, who's on the pitch for Swindon today. So the second half, Swindon playing left to right. Kevin Richardson, the Villa captain. Forward by Teal. Here's Yorke. Feels for handball, and that's been given. We'll see what part the wind has to play now in the second half, now that the teams have changed round. Here's Regis. McGrath.
Swindon have a few long-range shots, didn't they, in the first half, but now with the wind behind them, they might be better set to keep trying it. But again, I think to get them back into the game, a feature of their play has been the two fullbacks, Bowden and Kerslake, like to get forward, but they haven't had much opportunity. I mean, we had one good run from Kerslake in the corner in the first half, but Bowden hasn't been able to get to the byline. And the longer this half goes on, if it stays 1-0, they'll have to take the chance of getting forward. Although, of course, Glenn Hoddle has got the unpredictable skill of Fitzroy Simpson on the bench as well.
Yes, I'm pretty certain we'll see Simpson if Swindon don't equalise early in the half. He's an exciting player, one that's being pursued by other clubs at the moment, but he lost his place through suspension initially, hasn't got it back. The other Swindon sub is Nicky Somerby, the son of Mike Somerby, who started his career here, of course. There's Fitzroy Simpson. And there's... He looks a bit like his dad, doesn't he, Somerby? Regis. And now Parker. Dwight Yorke just holding his run well. Tony Daly was the target. This is Taylor. And lots going to depend now on whether Hazard can purvey the ball around and dictate the game in the middle of the field. He's found Ling, who had a terrific first half, number four. Villa appealing for hands against him, not given. This is Hazard. Shearer. And it's still Hazard. Foul given against Staunton, quickly taken. This is Jones. Mitchell in the middle. Bowden comes forward from the full-back position to get the header in.
Didn't get into those positions that often in the first half. So it's interesting so early to see him get there at the far post, and I think that's what's going to happen more and more as the second half, as we say, progresses.
The only thing is, if Swindon, which they have to do, push forward with plenty of bodies, there's always the danger that Daly or maybe Yorke could catch them on the break with a swift counter with the speed they've got. That throw in from Kubicki. They obviously throw it a different way in Poland. Here he is again. This is Richardson. McLaren. Calderwood, forced across the field by Froggatt. This is Taylor, number six, Sean Taylor. Offside, Mitchell. Parker. All the other clubs still in the FA Cup will be, I'm sure, watching this.
and looking forward to the draw for the sixth round, which comes up live for you from FA headquarters as soon as this match is over. The draw for the sixth round, the last time that home advantage applies. We're getting that bit closer on the road to Wembley. Hazard for Swindon. Taylor. Ling. And now it's Jones. Oh, giving it away. Regis. Now York's got Froggatt steaming up on the left. Here he is, number 11. Regis in the penalty area being joined by Daly. Oh, and Regis didn't jump and Taylor did.
That was the classic counter-attack, because the reason they got Froggatt in down the left there was, of course, Kerslake had made the run in for the attack to give the width to Swindon. When it does break down like that, that's when you capitalise on the stake, the sort of space in that corner. And they nearly conceded a second goal.
Well, now Froggatt has gone across to take the corner, and McGrath and Staunton are lined up in there. Goes Staunton, McGrath as far away as Richardson. It can go back again to Froggatt, and Dwight Yorke with the goalkeeper, and Regis poised, and Swindon get the ball away. Froggatt settling down nicely in the First Division and FA Cup scene. There's quite a big playing staff at Aston Villa, and indeed Ron Atkinson has done a tremendous amount of transfer dealing since he took over as manager there at the beginning of the season. Flags up on the far side. I think at the latest count, Ron Atkinson had sold 15 players for about £9.5 million and bought 10 for about £5 million. Well played, Hazard. He cost a bit of money in his day. Jones. Foden. Ling. Mitchell. Oh, couldn't edge it on to Ling. It was Teal who was in the way. Kerslake. Still Kerslake. Oh, it's Shearer, and it's wide.
Good play by Kerslake. There he is, jogging back. Comes inside, Staunton gets a toe ender, and Shearer, instinctively stretching, could have flown in the net, just pulled it across the face of the goal. You'd have to say it was a good chance, but only 9 or 10 yards out. And although he was challenged and stretching, somebody who's got 18 league goals and 28 league goals in all this season, I think he'd be disappointed.
Here he goes again. It's Shearer with Seeley coming out. I think only Aldridge has scored more goals this season than Shearer. And he was so keen to impress today. I saw him at Chelsea in midweek watching a game, and he was saying he hoped that the Swindon lads wouldn't freeze in front of the cameras. Well, they haven't done that. But so far, they've had little luck. And they now force the pace on the left-hand side with Bodin taking the throw. Here's Ling. Bodin again. Header by McGrath. Shearer again. Hazard, wide to Kerslake. And they knew, or Staunton knew, which way Kerslake was going to go there. But the momentum at the moment is with Swindon. This is Jones, Hazard, and still. Oh, Shearer was waiting for the ball to come to him, and it was McGrath. And this is the kind of counter-attack where Villa could be dangerous. It's Tony Daly, and he's skipped round Sean Taylor, and Regis is in the middle, and so is Yorke. And Daly shoots, and shoots wide. So should he have crossed?
Just a bit, dear. I mean, he's done so well. Again, Swindon just caught with men forward. He skips past the first tackle. Now he's got plenty of time to have a look up here. Bowden is trying to get back. And really, if you're going to shoot, you've got to shoot to the far post. You see Cyril Regis coming in there, could easily have got the touch. He'll be disappointed, but annoyed more than anything will be Cyril Regis. I'd like to be on the dressing room, see what he says.
Jones, Mitchell, Shearer far post. Swindon come again. Still Mitchell. Hazard. doing well again. This is Kerslake. It's too long. I think Shearer was looking around thinking Bowden might have crept up from left back, but he hadn't then. This is Daly. Taylor. Mitchell. Uh-oh. Caught by Staunton. It won't be a red card because Teal was behind Staunton. He wasn't the last man. It wouldn't have been a goal-scoring opportunity. But it was a trip on David Mitchell. 10 minutes gone in the second half. I mean, you've got to book him for that. Yellow card, Staunton. Now, Calderwood is up on the far side. Taylor has gone to join him there. Hazard to Kerslake, and it comes off Staunton. Mick Hazard claimed handball, in fact it's a corner. Now last week against Brighton, Swindon got great joy from their set plays at this end of the pitch. Calderwood is a man to watch. But Villa knew who was marking who there, it was effective, and this is Daly. Better by Staunton. Parker. Yorke. Regis. Taylor gets a foot in, tries to charge on again. Oh, good play by Sean Taylor. There's 60-40 against him, but he won it. And the ball played through for Mitchell, and McGrath gets a foot there.
Just beginning to get a bit more incisive with those last passes, Swindon. You just feel a little sense that they feel they've got a chance now. One or two little half openings starting to occur.
Determined play by number six, Taylor, in the build-up. He's now gone up for the corner. It's played back to Bowden. Whisked in. Shearer's header!
Game, good worked corner, laid it back, good first time cross, just got the faintest of touches. Shearer just coming in at the far post, I think would have got an offside decision there, but again they do, you can see they spent a lot of time in training on their set pieces. The free kick with Hazard and Kerslake before was a good one, and again a short corner there.
Well, it's gripping stuff, isn't it? Can the second division side pull this round, or are Aston Villa going to hold firm in this FA Cup tie? Down at the county ground. Glenn Hoddle, now a standing spectator with John Gorman down in front of the dugout. Calderwood for Swindon. Kerslake. Hazard. And McLaren. Shearer. Kerslake again. It's a good move, this, by Swindon, but once more, Teal is firm for Aston Villa. What a good season he's had at the back. This is Regis. And now it's Parker. Nice skill. Villa can open it up now to the right. Kubicki. Daly outside him. Parker. Here's Daly. Looking for Yorke. Right and left, waiting for somebody to make a run. Nobody really helped him out there. He had to play it short. McLaren. Swung it wide for Kerslake. Ling. McLaren. Hazard. McLaren. Shearer! Blocked by Paul McGrath. It's all Swindon again, isn't it? They've been on top for nearly the whole game. Jones. McLaren. But Seeley, who distinguished himself with that save in the first half from Mitchell, is having a good day.
There's a sweeper that Ross McLaren's had two shots, hasn't he? One turned out to be a good pass to Duncan Shearer. He turned and had his shot blocked, and that other one got through. He's starting to move up more. I can remember in his Derby days, he's quite got a long, good long-range shot and does tank the ball when he gets hold of it.
Here's Regis, back to Richardson. Villa's turn to attack. We've been playing now for an hour. The score is still Swindon 0, Aston Villa 1. Dwight Yorke's goal, 6 minutes before half-time. Here's Ling for Swindon. Bowden to Mitchell. He's up against McGrath. Bowden again. Hazard. Kersley. Mitchell with his arm up on the far side. And this is Regis. Now Yorke, the goal scorer, and Richardson's coming up on this side as well. McLaren. Kerslake, Hazard, and now it's Taylor. Jones. Well, First Division sides have to put their backs to the wall sometimes, and Villa have certainly done that. They've been forced back. And you have to say that there's been some good defending by McGrath and Teal in the centre of the defence. And some hard work by Richardson and Parker in midfield. Here's Taylor. McLaren. Ling put that back nicely. Here's Kerslake. Back heel was by Richardson. Froggatt. Uh-oh, we've got trouble here. It's Yorke and Regis. If he makes ground on the far side, can have an open run here. But it's still Yorke and still Dwight Yorke, and he lost his balance. This is Parker, and now it's Froggatt. And there's the shot, and what a goal by the 18-year-old. Stephen Froggatt. Well, if York hadn't made a mess of it, we would have been denied that superb goal after 63 minutes. Steve Froggatt, only 18, will remember this cup tie. Look at that, a left-foot shot, like an arrow in the top corner, past Nicky Hammond. It's 2-0 to Aston Villa. What do you make of that, Trevor?
Well, it's a quite magnificent strike. I mean, you've got the camera just... As soon as it left his foot, it was a goal. And... For an 18-year-old, he's got very talented left foot. We've seen him in a few games, haven't we? But to start scoring goals like that, you can understand why Ron Atkinson has had to accommodate him in the side by sort of switching Yorke and Daly in turn up front. But a magnificent goal. Just as it seemed, Dwight Yorke had missed a golden opportunity to go 2-0.
It's his first goal for Aston Villa, Steve Froggatt, and he'll never forget it, will he? Was a candidate for goal of the season. This is Kerslake. Hazard. And away by McGrath. Richardson. Now this has given Aston Villa a grip on the game, which is a First Division team they should not lose. That's Teal. Jones, Hazard. Uh-oh, Regis. This is where Swindon lose the ball and then get caught out. It's Daly on the right. Support coming up from three other players here for Villa. Still Daly, Regis. Shearer. Hazard. McLaren. just trying to hold their position so as not to go offside. Kerslake. Jones. Mitchell's there. There is just one thing about the system that Swindon play, Trevor. I think you probably made the point earlier, Alan Hansen did, that when the fullbacks push right up, there is space in behind them, isn't there? And that's really where Villa got away there initially.
Well, it was, and Russ McLaren was sort of pushing forward more and more as the sweeper, almost making an extra midfield player. And of course, if he's caught out, your sweeper as well. They were exposed almost 3-2 and 2-1. And it's not surprising that Fitzroy Simpson now coming on. He's got a lot of skill. Very unpredictable, though. I mean, he suddenly goes past two players and conjures up something and then does something silly. So I'm sure Ben Holby keeping his fingers crossed that he's going to show some of the talent that he definitely has. Because at the moment, 2-0, you have to say Villa will be looking good, I'm sure, feeling good.
20 minutes gone in the second half. Tom Jones was the player who went off for Swindon, number 9. Fitzroy Simpson, 22 years old, in 10 days' time. He's been watched by a number of First Division clubs this season. And so he has an opportunity now, wearing number 14, to make his case in an FA Cup tie. Here's Shearer, Ling, Froggatt, Yorke, Froggatt again, Regis. Uh-oh, York's through again. They've been caught out once more, Swindon, and here's Dwight Yorke. Not away, it's Daly. And here's Gary Parker, and Regis, and Staunton. I think there was a flag up for offside earlier. But we praised Swindon's football quality in the first half, but you've got to speak about their vulnerability when they have to commit players forward, because Villa now are finding gaps, as we suspected they might. Here's Mitchell though for Swindon, good header by Teal. Aston Villa supporters are enjoying their afternoon in the West. They're 2 goals up now, and it's looking as though, from the play we've seen in the last few minutes, as though it could be more. Then again, if Swindon could get one back, what a climax we could have. This is McGrath. Taylor, Bowden, Simpson. Little lull in the game as everybody gets their breath back and their thoughts together. Ron Atkinson and Andy Gray still doing the pointing from one side of the picture, and Glenn Hoddle on his feet on the other. And I think Mr. Atkinson has disturbed the referee in some way. Whether there's been some shouting between the two benches, I'm not sure, but it seems to be very good humoured down there, Trevor.
I don't think Big Ron will worry too much about that. Perhaps they were just checking times of the trains after the game.
It said, you know, that Ron wanted to sign Glenn Hoddle once. I think when Atkinson was at Manchester United and Hoddle was coming towards the end of a contract at Spurs, there was some talk. I think they met, in fact, and discussed a possible transfer, but Glenn Hoddle wanted to go abroad at the time. Well, Fitzroy Simpson knocked his own player out the way. Froggatt. Hazard is driven back. Whatever you say about the way you like to see football play, you can have as many passes as you like, but you've got to get shots in at the end to get anywhere. Swindon have done all the passing, But Villa have had the two shots that matter. Here's Kubicki. Richardson. There goes Daly. We have 20 minutes to go here at Swindon, and it's 2-0 to First Division Aston Villa in this FA Cup fifth round tie. Here's Hazard for Swindon. Through to Mitchell. And it came back off Mitchell in the end. Sean Teales was the challenge. And I would say Sean Teale, Trevor, one of the most improved players I've seen in the First Division this season.
Yes, it was a good signing for Bournemouth. And I think the experience of playing alongside Paul McGrath had done me a lot of good. But he's a good, fierce competitor and strong tackler. And has balanced well with McGrath. I think just today, the only thing I would say on Swindon, Mitchell and Shearer together are a little bit similar. They have got the pace to actually get behind defences, and I think that's something perhaps Glenn Hull will have to think about, because they've played a lot of good stuff in front of the Villa back four, but haven't often, because of the lack of pace, been able to get behind.
That's the way it is. Here's Hazard. The ball gets that far deep into the Swindon half. Villa are now pushing up and snapping at the Swindon players and not allowing them to play out as they were in the first half. Again, that the draw for the sixth round of the FA Cup is coming up live after the match, and it's looking at this stage as though Aston Villa's name will be in that draw. Kubicki takes the throw. There's Regis. This is Bodin, and now Simpson.
It's a bit of a weekend where the First Division clubs have re-established themselves in the competition, just as in the previous round we thought perhaps someone from another division, the second division, might come through to get to the final or win the competition. The First Division clubs have bounced back with the force, haven't they, this weekend?
They certainly have. Passing very accurate from the back by Swindon, but McGrath is there, a solid block, and the ball goes into the Aston Villa half. There goes Yorke. Daly's with him. It's a Villa throw. Good ground for Aston Villa. The year they came back to the First Division, they clinched promotion here. Now they're 2-0 up in the cup. There's Regis. Header out was by Taylor. Then it was Simpson. Now it's Staunton. I was saying it was, 35 years since Villa have won the FA Cup, but quite a few of their players out there today have been to Wembley with different clubs. This is Froggatt on the ball. Steve Staunton played for Liverpool in the cup final, Regis for Coventry, McGrath for Manchester United, so Gary Parker for Forest, Richardson for Everton. In fact, they've probably got more than half a team who've played on the biggest day of all. Good header again by Teal. This is McLaren. McGrath. It's two against one here. Calderwood had to win it. Kerslake. Shearer. Here's Hazard. Quarter of an hour to go. Can he get Bowden in here? Mitchell! And Swindon are back in it. And they've scored at last. David Mitchell puts Glenn Hoddle's team back in with a shout in the cup tie. And the system worked there for Swindon. They got down the left-hand side with Bowden drilled across, and Mitchell really had an easy finish. It's 2-1.
That's a marvellous pass from Hazard. What a cross that is. Look, inch perfect. And Mitchell, that is one, a dream one for a striker on a plate. And I think we might have an exciting run at up to the final whistle. The first time, perhaps, Tony Daly hasn't worked back with Bowden. He got 2 or 3 yards on him. And again, there might be a word about that after the match.
I'll tell you what, this has become a really good game, hasn't it, eh? Swindon deserved the goal for what they did in the first half. And it's now 2-1, and anything can happen. And that's just what you want from a cup tie. The second division team didn't let their supporters down. They kept plugging away, and they got their reward. Big Mitchell was in the right place. And Ron Atkinson now faces an anxious few minutes, perhaps. Froggatt. Shearer. Well, could they come and equalise? Ling. And now Mitchell's out left. Fitzroy Simpson in support. Kubicki obstructed him. Free kick. Calderwood makes his way forward. So does Sean Taylor. Chances here then for Swindon. The whole ground is lifted now. There's Taylor with the header back, Ling with the header in. Mitchell's in there, himself with the overhead kick. And there'll be the train that needed because two Villa players seem to collide there. So the Swindon physio, Kevin Morris, is coming on as well. I think this happened when Sean Taylor headed the ball back across goal, and you'll see Mitchell in a minute go for an overhead kick, but it's there, the two challengers, Teal and McGrath on Shearer, and the two Villa players got hurt. Well, this game has turned round a bit, Mr. Brooking.
Well, that's a nasty cut, as you can see. I mean, looked as if when they went in, it might have been just as Shearer's got up. It's caught his elbow, and certainly Sean Teal possibly will need stitches. Paul McGrath laid out, and as you can see, it's a hanging ball. Duncan Shearer goes up, he just leads with his elbow, and I think it's that that's caught the eye of Teal, and possibly McGrath caught the header. But I mean, he's not too sure where he is. Not the ideal time to perhaps lose one of your centre-backs, but they both look a bit groggy at the moment.
Well, they might need to use Brian Small, one of the subs who's a defender. He's got him warming up for Ron Atkinson further down the line. McGrath looks badly shaken. Spot of concussion there for sure. I'm not too thrilled about the elbow on Teal. I think it was an elbow, by the way. But whether you call that deliberate or not in a jump, I don't really know. Anyway, Teal has certainly got a bad cut. And he's shaken up also. Well, what drama we've had here the last few minutes. Aston Villa seem to be coasting to a 2-0 win. Swindon got a goal back. And now it's all happening. McGrath back on his feet, but the more serious case is Teal. Steely came tearing out, as he tends to do, in protest, possibly because he thought an elbow was used.
I would have thought Les Seeley might have learnt his lesson. I mean, whatever you think, you've just got to rely on the referee to see it and deal with it. But it's one of those possibly where he would need stitches after the game. It's just a case of whether those strips can keep it just for the last few minutes until afterwards.
Well, just let's see this again, Trevor, because it's quite important what happens here. Shearer goes up. The left elbow is definitely, in my view, in the face of Sean Teale. Quite where McGrath got hurt. Oh, he was on the other side of him. That's obviously where he bumped into the other player, but there was an elbow used. And I think the reaction of Teale is beginning to demonstrate that too.
Actually, on the replay there, you saw, unfortunately for Ray Lewis, he was actually behind that play. He would have had no opportunity at all to see it from this side as we did, the actual elbow going first.
No, it's easy to see it from a second or third view, isn't it, from a different angle. Referees can't see those. The same the other night at Bristol Rovers, when in fact there wasn't just one elbow, there were two. One, in my opinion, on Dean Saunders. Anyway, that's all history now. It's still 2-1 to Aston Villa, and we've got about 10 minutes to play in this fifth round cup tie, and it's by no means over.
If anything, it might have been a disservice to Swindon, because, you know, after a long delay like that, they had the momentum, they just got one goal back, the crowd was noisy, and suddenly the game just got a bit flat because of the long break, and they've got to pick it up again and start to push forward.
Well, it certainly is one of the most lively cup ties I've seen this season. This is Calderwood. Here's Hazard wanting to get the ball off the goalkeeper and start it all over again from the back for Swindon. Aiming at Shearer, little touch meant for Ling, away by Parker. Taylor, Mitchell on the chase, and Seeley's going to come out. They're looking across at the linesman, the Villa defenders, but he wasn't offside. Well, we could be in for an exciting 8 minutes here. Swindon fans have found their voices again, and it's all very tense down there. Ling, McGrath, Hazard, can he find Kerslake on the right? He can. His cross, but straight into the arms of the grateful Seeley. I would imagine they're going to use Brian Small, because those defenders who collided in the goal mouth are definitely suffering from reaction, maybe concussion. Cleared by Kubicki. Regis. Dwight Yorke is over that side too. Nice little ball by Taylor to Bowden. In it goes to McLaren. Swindon able to play their football again now. Out to Hazard. Plenty of players forward in red here. Teale stretches. It comes back to Hazard again. Ling. Good little exchange, but Parker quickly in. It was too intricate, really, by Swindon. And this is Yorke. Daly, it's out. In fact, Dwight Yorke, who you thought was also carrying an injury, Trevor, early in the game, is the player going off. So they must feel that, well, he's probably going to play as an extra defender anyway, Small, I would have thought. He'll be extra cover back there. Maybe go to left back and let Staunton go into midfield. Here's Ling.
Yeah, you're quite right. That is a tactic, right? Small, you know, is a left back, and so they just shoved Staunton into the midfield to congest it even more, because they do like to play intricate patterns in that area, Swindon. that's going to be difficult now, whether they decide to persevere with that or perhaps just try and go over the top or get those fullbacks in. But what, the last 5 or 6 minutes, I think Ron Atkinson, not surprised, has decided to shut up shop.
Time yet for the second division Swindon. Bowden placing the ball for the free kick. Sean Taylor and Calderwood are on their way up. There are 5 minutes to go. That's Taylor's header. Calderwood was just off that. Good wholehearted football here. Nice mix of the two styles, and a fine cup tie has resulted. Here's Teal. Taylor taking up the near side position on the 6 yard line. He's in the middle of that crowd of players. It's back again with Kerslake. Header out by Regis. McLaren shot, hit Kevin Richardson. That's a corner. Corner to Swindon. Taylor and Mitchell facing the kicker. Header by McGrath again. Daly. Ling. McLaren. Back in by Kerslake. And the flick on almost worked. Bowden. Little flick in, or it was meant for Taylor. Here's Bowden again. Was he brought down? 3 minutes to go, and it was a careless place to give away a free kick. Can Swindon equalise? Bowden and Hazard over the ball. Is Taylor. It's out. It's out. It's a goal kick.
They just tried to vary it a bit and go beyond the far post, but with a swirly wind, just took it a little bit too far, and Sean Taylor couldn't get to it before it went behind the byline. And Les Seeley, not surprisingly, taking his time for this kick.
Just over a couple of minutes to go. Regis Richardson. Well, we're going to go back now. Wonder what would happen if FIFA ever banned the back pass to the goalkeeper. We'd have some football then, wouldn't we?
Hey, would you? Might also get some wellies into the stand, as well as players panic and realise they can't pass it back and have to get rid of the ball pretty quick.
Yeah, wouldn't solve the problem. Here's Parker. Good ball to Staunton. Stand by for the 6th round draw, because we have 1 minute left here at the county ground, plus stoppage time. Swindon trail 2-1 to Aston Villa, but they've not given up hope yet. Here's big Sean Taylor in the attack, headed out by Teal. Now Staunton, Daly. There's one for Froggatt to chase with Calderwood.
McLaren, McGrath, Richardson. McLaren again, aiming for Mitchell on the left-hand side. Kubicki's header, then Parker's. Regis and McLaren. Calderwood, the Swindon fans urging them forward as Taylor drives on here. Hazard. Simpson. Stoppage time as Bowden takes the throw and looks for Ling. Here's Ling. Hazard. Kerslake. It's back to him again from Shearer. Here's Ling. Mitchell. Parker's sliced clearance, Brian Small's more effective one, but in fact the referee had given a free kick way back on the edge of the Villa penalty area against Dave Mitchell. Villa know they're almost there now. Is Calderwood. Well, for once, Nicky Hammond will have to kick it. There's not enough time left to build up from the back now. Headed by McGrath. Regis. Showing a sprightly piece of energy there, Cyril Regis. He's found Froggatt. Staunton. Richardson. We're into the third minute of stoppage time. And Aston Villa are in the quarter-finals of the FA Cup. Ron Atkinson and Andy Gray see their side defeat second division Swindon thanks to partially a goal from Steve Froggatt on 63 minutes that made it 2-0 and pushed the tie that little bit further away from Swindon. Although they got a goal back, just look at the celebrations there. Les Seeley letting his hair down as they go over to the supporters. Although Swindon got a goal back through Mitchell 15 minutes from the end, it wasn't enough on the day. Glenn Hoddle's team did him proud, especially in the first half. And Trevor Brooking, that was a gripping cup tie for the spectator.
Well, I was very excited. I think you have to say Stephen Froggatt's shot was one of the best you're likely to see. I mean, he has got a super left foot, but to hit one like that, and from the minute he's left his boot, it was a goal. And certainly any goal like that perhaps deserves to win a cup tie. But Villa were not at their best, I didn't feel, today. Swindon had long spells when they were the better side, perhaps just missing out on the last incisive pass, that was all. But they did themselves credit, and but in the end, it's Villa in the hat.
Well, certainly, Froggatt's picture will be in the papers tomorrow. Only 18, his first senior goal. What a day to remember for him, and the Aston Villa supporters will be looking forward now, as we are, to the draw for the sixth round in a few minutes, because their team are safely through, and the First Division seems to have restored the order of the FA Cup this weekend. And I believe Ray Stubbs is waiting in the tunnel with one of the victorious.
Well, that wasn't easy, was it?
Well, yeah, it was a very difficult game for us, and eventually we get through the game and came out on top. It was just delightful to get the result in the end.
And you got a goal just when it mattered.
Yes, at the time we were hanging on 1-0, the first goal. Of course, yeah, nice ball into Tamayo there, just taking on the defender. Dummy him at first, he went for the dummy, and then a good shot, give the keeper no chance really, and it's just delightful to see it going in at the end.
What did your manager say at half-time?
Well, he just said to us, pick up the tempo a bit, because they at the time was the better team, and as I said, the goal seems to be the turning point for us, and at the second half, we just get the second goal, which was enough to get the result in the end.
And here's the score of the second goal there. Stephen Froggatt, what a strike that was.
I don't think I'll hit a better one than that in my career. I mean, I'm just, you know, really pleased that we're in the next round of the Cup.
Really, just at that time, Swindon looked like they were coming back at you again.
Yeah, obviously, I mean, they did put us under a hell of a lot of pressure. And half-time, the boss wasn't too happy with the way we were performing. But I think in the second half, we battled a lot more. And, well, we're through. That's all that matters, I suppose, now.
Congratulations, gentlemen.
Thank you very much.
The two scorers that put Aston Villa into that sixth-round draw coming up in a few minutes' time. The day, Jimmy, when the counter-punchers beat the Boxers.
Yes, yes. You've got to, I suppose, admire Villa's resilience in the end to take that amount of punishment and still, you know, somehow snatch the game. But it was a brilliant goal, you know, absolutely fantastic goal that ended up as being the winning goal of the game.
Yeah. Well, you've done well to hold your concentration there because a few yobs are throwing stones at the window, but you've got to expect it sometimes. Alan?
Yes, I mean, this was a fantastic goal that Froggatt hits into the back of the net. A super goal. Swindon were unlucky, but they played exceptionally well. But when you play as well as that, luck shouldn't come into it. They always look to me like they'll concede goals. Mm-hmm. And they played superb on the day. Hazard was magnificent. They played great football. They were a credit to themselves and their supporters. Villa didn't play well on the day, and I thought they were lucky to get through.
OK. Right, well, now, Liverpool drew at Ipswich.
They're now back in striking distance of the playoffs with a match against fellow promotion hopefuls Portsmouth to come this Saturday. Promises to be worth 6 points to the winner. Swindon put themselves firmly back on the playoff trail with a decisive win over close rivals Southend. Kerslake and Jones combining on the right, the cross met by Dave Mitchell. Following up for his 32nd goal of the season, Duncan Shearer, who now equals Don Rogers' post-war record set in 1967. Southend forced themselves level on the half-hour, delightful through ball from Steve Tilson, and the answer's perfect chip, too good for Fraser Digby. Then, just after half-time, a controversial incident that gave Swindon the lead. Mitchell chasing and challenging goalkeeper Sansom, but defender Pryor holding him back, the referee awarding a penalty, and Welsh international Paul Bodin stepping up to slot it home. And Swindon made sure of the 3 points when Duncan Shearer was put clear on the left. Southend thought he was offside, but he drew Sansom, and Dave Mitchell slotted the ball home, Swindon very much back in the playoff race. And a nice gesture from Swindon. They've offered to stage a league match for the 4th Division strugglers Aldershot if the Shots can get their winding-up order in the High Court. They'll then be able to borrow the county ground on Friday for the match against Yorke. Bristol Rovers only managed to draw at...
There could be as much as 5 minutes of that. Scott Green's third of the season, and it's 2-2, Bolton in Division 3 against 1st Division Southampton. And there's a lot more left in this yet.
There certainly is. That was it, 2-2. Both those clubs then go into the draw, and we're about to see it now as we go live to FA headquarters and Graham Kelly.
Thank you, Des. Well, a great fight back by Bolton, and Bolton or Southampton go into the draw as number 5. The home teams will be drawn by Mr. Gordon McKeague, the chairman of the Challenge Cup Committee, and the away teams by Mr. Chris Wilcox, the vice-chairman of the Football Association.
Number 8.
Ipswich Town or Liverpool.
Number 3.
We'll play Aston Villa.
Number 2.
Portsmouth or Middlesbrough.
Number 7.
We'll play Nottingham Forest.
Number 1.
Chelsea.
Number 6.
Sunderland or West Ham United.
Number 5.
Bolton Wanderers or Southampton.
Number 4.
We'll play Norwich City. That concludes the draw. The tie's to be played the 7th, 8th and 9th of March. Back to you at Swindon, Des.
Graham, thank you very much indeed. Well, as I think John Mawson was saying earlier, it didn't have a First Division look about it, the Cup, this season, but it certainly has now. And for their pains here today, Villa will play either Ipswich or Liverpool. Now, Kevin Richardson, the Villa captain, is with us. Let's hear from him.
Well, reaction to the draw, Kevin?
Great draw for us. We've had a hard round so far in the Cup. And we've got another one with Liverpool or Ipswich. But, you know, we've done well today and we're looking forward going to either place. We've got a fancy with chances now.
You don't mind going to Portman Road or Anfield and getting a good result?
Yeah, we've done it at Swindon, Derby and Tottenham. Why not Anfield or Portman Road?
Great character today.
Yeah, we had to. Swindon played very well. Some lovely football. They give us a lot of pressure and a lot of problems. But our lads battled well and I would think deservedly went into the next round.
Thanks for talking to us.
Thank you.
So a good match here today and a good draw. I've had a postcard from Mr. Terry Cridland, who comes from Ashford in Kent, who tells me that he spotted what you've been doing, incidentally, for the last week or so. He spotted you out there.
Spotted me doing what?
Out there. You've been there. How did you get the? Where did you get the suit from? That's what...
Listen, I'm not taking this lying down. I think that man's impersonating me. Who is he?
I don't know. But we want to know, if you're doing the singles, why you don't do the doubles in a loop.
Wife wouldn't let me.
Last thought or two on today's
really
match.
A wonderful cut tie. Yeah. Had everything about it. Courage as well. That three players going for that header, blood all over the place, fought out, massive amount of skill in the game. You know, drama as well. Couldn't ask for any more. And if the rest of the ties are like that on the way to Wembley, we're not going to grumble.
Yes, absolutely super. I hope you've enjoyed it at home. You now know why people like watching Swindon play, but Aston Villa did the trick here today. You've seen the draw, so there's lots more to come on the road to Wembley with BBC Television. We certainly hope you enjoyed this, and you'll enjoy a lot more with us. From us, it's goodbye.
Terracotta burial ornament from the 5th century BC. It's a fake.
Good day, Sir Desmond.
No, don't go. Not yet. The pig. Give me the pig.
A disaster for Lovejoy, tonight at 7:45.
Our bona fide team of antiques experts will be along in 25 minutes for more valuations on some of your undiscovered treasures. This week, Yeovilton in Somerset is the location for the roadshow. And that's after we smarten up our act with the show on the cutting edge of haute couture.
Ashton Gate is home sweet home for Bristol City these days. Andy Cole leads the chase for goals as they go for 5 league wins in a row. Swindon Town overcame their away day blues at West Ham and Newcastle, but Glenn Hoddle's men aren't always so convincing away from the county ground. The pride of the West's at stake as Bristol City take on Swindon Town. Hello, there's nothing like a local derby to get the adrenaline flowing and to set the pulse racing. A crowd of just over 14,000 piled into Ashton Gate to watch the latest clash between two old rivals. And they weren't disappointed. It was a match of high-class football and no shortage of goals. There's also more football action from around the First Division. Much of action or goals in our main match. Bristol City against Swindon Town, with commentary by Roger Malone.
And a very warm welcome to Ashton Gate. It's a wet day for what could be a hot encounter. Local derbies usually are. Bristol City introduced Danish international defender Bjorn Christensen at number four, signed on loan from Newcastle to cover David Thompson's suspension. And Polish international Jackie Jakanowski, wearing number eight, is recalled to sit his midfield. Swindon Town are able to field their regular lineup after number seven, their midfield playmaker, Mickey Hazard, recovered from last week's stomach and muscle injury. And wearing number nine, there is Craig Maskell, the leading goal scorer in the West region and the third leading marksman in the First Division. The referee for the West match is Peter Jones of Loughborough. And it's Swindon Town playing right to left in their away colours of green tops and navy blue shorts that get the West match in action. City, of course, in their usual red and white. That's Bryant against Craig Maskell straight away. Swindon come here off a good run of away success, winning 1-0 at West Ham and then holding the leaders Newcastle. The kick had to be instant there by Nicky Hammond under the new laws. That's a problem for goalkeepers. Jakanowski taking on Horlock, getting round him. Good cross, great chance. Lovely opportunity there. Cole hooking it just wide. City fans appreciate that. See the control of Jakanowski in tight spaces. Beat young Horlock, good cross. Good hook shot by Cole, just off target. Jakanowski. Taylor closes. Rossignol. Jakanowski. Just kept it in. Horlock this time gets a block on it. Jakanowski's corner. City enjoying a good spell in this opening 10-15 minutes. Good header there, super header there by Rossignol, headed off the line. Well, you saw what a good header that was, and I think it was Ling on the line there, heading that off. Good positioning, good defence, good attack too by City. Cole beaten to it by Taylor. Bryant. Horlock. Hazard, Horlock, Maskell doesn't get it, Osman has it. Bryant, Russell Osman, Gary Shelton. Andy Cole. Good cross. Chance here for Scott. Well, he mishit that, it fell to his left foot, which is his favourite. Get another chance for City. Are they letting them slip away? Will it be to their cost? Shelton, Mitchell. There's the cross. Oh, it's Rossignol against the post. Lovely cross, lovely flick of the head. Swindon survived by inches. We see the simplicity of the move. And City very close once again. Jakanowski. Locked by that man Calderwood and Hoddle. The way comes Swindon, lucky to be alive still, score-wise. Horlock to Ling in space. Edwards is marshalling. Not Ling's game so far. Oh, this is Rossignol. Three against three. Cole, Jakanowski in position. So is Rossignol, this is Cole. Hammond gets it away. Well, Andy Cole there, going for goal number 13 this season. Unlucky for some. Hazard. Jakanowski against Hoddle. Two internationals. Lovely little duel. Good interception by Calderwood. Swindon having to stretch to survive. Scott. Jakanowski. Scott. Hazard caught by Edwards. Free kick to Swindon. Hazard. For Mitchell, he's through. This is dangerous. He's got Somerby inside. It's pulled back and it's Scott getting a boot on it. Mitchell again. Osman has it. Chance for Maskell. It's there. It's there. Swindon Town, Craig Maskell. His 16th goal of the season, and the Swindon fans celebrate. Well, you can see City thought they'd cleared it, but when it fell to Maskell, he doesn't miss those. And on the basis of the play so far, you could call it daylight robbery. This is Maskell. Horlock. Ling. Oh, Hoddle, chance for him to have a shot. Well, he hit it well, didn't he, on the run, the former England maestro, but slightly wide of the post. Well, there's the 53 England cap man run onto that one. You could see him thinking, I could have this one. Hit it nicely, but just wide of the left-hand post. Osman. Oh, it's a good one, super ball. Didn't break too well for Cole. Chance for Shelton. It's there. Very good goal indeed by Gary Shelton. So City equalised right on the stroke of half time. And the Aston great faithful. Love that. See the quality of Osmond's pass. Cole did awfully well. And so did Shelton. Marauding up there for his third goal of the season. So Bristol City get the second half of the West match in motion, playing right to left in their normal red and white. They probably enjoyed their half-time cup of tea a bit better. They scored so close to the interval, and deservedly so too. Won all the score. Well, there's a novel clearance by young Nicky Hammond. There's an inventive piece of goalkeeping. Jakanowski. Horlock. Osman, Shelton. And number 12 there on for City, Jerry Harrison, the substitute used at half-time. Kersley, Hazard. Oh, lovely control there to beat young Edwards. And Huddle's in a little bit of trouble with the pass, though. So was Maskell. City got stuck in and got that back. This is Jakanowski. Summerby, Maskell. Oh, the good cross skill again by the Swindon players. Freeing Kersley. And the deflection of Christensen for the corner. Edwards cleared it. Jakanowski, Scott. It's Andy. Oh, yes. Good covering by Kersley, but Cole still has it. Taylor clears. Little example there of the quickness of Cole with his feet and to keep that ball away from defenders. Bryant. Shelton. Osman, Edwards, Jakanowski, chance for Cole, flag has come up, flag was up, Jakanowski hit the ball in the side netting anyway, but a bit more promising for City. Ling, Horlock, Ling. Hazard lets it run to Hoddle. And Kerslake's away now. He's in the box. Chance for Summerby. It's there. Super shot. Breakaway football. Nicky Summerby. 12 minutes into the second half. Swindon take the lead. It was the ball to Kerslake, wasn't it? And from then on, as long as Summerby shot well, like his dad used to do for England and Manchester City, it was a goal, and what a beauty. His dad would have been proud of that one.
Swindon's second goal, Nicky Summerby.
Osman. to Maskell. Has it. And Hoddle. And Kersley, who lay behind that second goal. Mitchell. Jakanowski to Rossini, chance here. It's an excellent shot, another excellent goal in this super match. The West match comes alive again as Leroy Rossini squares it up for the City. Rossini's third goal of the season, and City level again. Well, once again, you can see the excellence of the passing and the dynamism of the finishing. Scott. Edwards to Cole. Mitchell close. That's a good cross. And a super header there by Rossini. Only just over the top. Well, that was a quality cross and a Tommy Lawton type header. A flick of the head and a powerful ball just over the target. Kerslake, Hazard, Hawlock, Link, Hazard, lovely ball to Kerslake, taking on Jakanowski, getting a yard, half a yard. And Shelton sliding in and making sure it's gobbled up. This is Edwards. Again, a little bit slow on the ball, Edwards. Got caught again. Hoddle, Maskell, Christensen cleared. Good ball out of defence to Cole. This is where he can be very dangerous in this position, this boy. Jakanowski, there's the return. Chance for Cole. Good save by Hammond. Good goalkeeping. Well, a beautiful example of the combination of Cole and Jakanowski and of superb Hammond goalkeeping. Ling. Oh, good play by Kerslake. And Ling. Hazard. Hawlock letting rip. Ling again. Maskell to Ling. He's through. Chance. Oh, he's missed a wonderful chance there, Martin Ling, and he knows it. Goal. White. Knocked in by Ling. Cleared by Scott. To Somerville. He's going to have a crack. Good powerful shot. Nicely taken by Walsh. Osman. Can he pick out one of his forwards? Rossini. Scissors with Jakanowski. It's through for Cole. He's there, the keeper's out. And he smashes it against Collingwood's legs. Well, that was a close call for Swindon, wasn't it? Well, the referee has not played that much injury time, and he brings to the end a superb match. Two goals each, the West match finishes. The crowd give the game the applause it deserves.
Well, what a great game, especially when you consider the conditions. After the match, Roger sought the views of the two second-half goal scorers, Nicky Somerby of Swindon and Leroy Rossini of City.
I think we're a little bit disappointed, really, because we thought that we could have just like we may have been able to grab it, or when we took the 2-1 lead, is that we thought that we, you know, if we'd have just held on to it a bit longer and just like been a bit more defensive, a bit more professional, I thought we might have just been able to like put them off a bit.
A bit disappointed, to be honest. We had a lot of chance in the first half. They had a lot of the ball. I mean, they had a lot of possession, and they were a good side. They kicked the ball excellent. Mick Hazard was brilliant. But I think we had the better chances. We hit the post a couple of times and just, you know, shaved the crossbar a few times, and we thought we should have won it, really.
You had to come from behind twice.
Yeah, it showed a good spirit. You know, I mean, away from home, we haven't been having the best results, but at home, we've been unbeaten in the last three. And we come in, the crowd get behind us, and we keep plugging away. And it was nice to, you know, it showed good spirit within the team to come back, you know, twice in 2-1, 2-1, especially at the end there, gets a good Swindon side, especially when they keep the ball like that because they don't let you have the ball. And we plugged away, which is good.
Still second in the table?
Yeah. And, next week we've got Peterborough away on Sunday, which, you know, we just get our heads down again and hopefully pick something up from there.
They do say win your home games and get a point away is promotion.
Yeah, but like last season, I thought that was our downfall. Away from home, we didn't do too well away from home, and we're working on that this year. And I think we're starting off OK, you know. We've got to keep going away from home and, like, picking points up and win, you know, and winning.
Good luck. Thank you for talking to us, and let's hope it works out for you.
Thank you.
So honours even, and plenty for both sets of players to be pleased about. Well, Malcolm Allison had his second...
Especially for winter wear.
Yes, it'd probably be OK if it was for kind of like a summer wedding.
Yes, it'd be ideal then.
But is this the man that you thought you were going to marry?
No.
Right, now how about that?
Yeah, well...
It's narrow here,
it makes me look like a long blue tube, really. Just so straight and flat, you know.
Yeah, this is by a French designer, Agnes B. What do you think of this, Jilly?
It's too shiny. The colour's better, but it's the cut and everything I don't like at all. The overall effect, I really don't
doesn't
like
do much for him, does it? No. Yeah. Sorry, Agnes. Well, Jilly thought the last one was conservative, so what about this one, Peter? This is by Italian designer Gianni Versace, and he'll see you coming down the aisle in this one.
Yes.
What do you think of that?
Well, it's very striking. It's it's also very comfortable.
Classic understatement, isn't it, eh? So how about this one, Peter? This is like a sort of double-breasted with six buttons showing and sort of four doing up.
Feels a lot better, yeah. It looks a lot more wider lapels and a good deal broader. And the sleeves are definitely...
What I like is the length on this jacket is good on you. All of the others seemed a bit short.
That's right, yeah. Coming down to here is just right, I think.
This is much more like it. The shape's good, the fit's good. The only thing really that lets it down, I think, is the colour.
OK, I've got another one like this over there, so let's try another colour on that's a bit more dramatic.
Yes.
How does that feel?
It feels great, yeah. It feels really comfortable. It's just the right fit.
So what do you think of that one, Jill?
Well, it's a beautiful suit, but I'm still not happy about the fabric.
I mean, it is an extremely sophisticated worsted, madam. Change is the title of Lisa Stansfield's hit single, and it also signposts a change of image for her. Exit the kiss curl and the floppy hat and enter the new Lisa, who is the star model cover girl of the March issue of the Clothes Show magazine. This is the right time to believe in love. More serious now that you've become like a kind of major world star?
Well, I'm always relaxed about things like that because I think if you worry too much about it, you're probably going to make mistakes.
What, and the image becomes more important than the music?
Yeah, I mean, the most important thing to me is the music.
I mean, do people actually kind of like notice and stop in the street when they see you? Or do you kind of wear an old cardigan?
There's one man who goes in the pub where we drink called David, and he sort of got a very boomy voice like that, and he said, "Oh, hello, Lucy."